Hi, thank you for your interest in my presentation. My name is Julie Zhuo. I am a statistical programmer working in the pharmaceutical industry. Today, we are going to talk about how we can write SAS to generate SAS. There are three code generating techniques for many automation solutions. We are going to talk about three SAS techniques. We all know that SAS has a lot of automation techniques, including, for example, SAS macros, SAS arrays, and do loops. If you use Enterprise Guide, Enterprise Guide also has automation specific to the EG. Today, we are going to focus on SAS code generators because it does not always become intuitive for SAS programmers to think in terms of maybe I can write some SAS code, which will generate a lot of SAS code so that we can improve efficiency and also maybe accomplish automations that cannot be accomplished otherwise. The three SAS code generators we are going to talk about are: first, we can create and resolve a macro variable. It doesn't really matter which method you use to generate a macro variable. You can use the broad SQL select into rows, or if you prefer, also the call symbol. The second technique is the call execute routine. The syntax is very simple, as shown here. The argument in the syntax can be any SAS code or any variable from a SAS dataset. And the last technique is to use put statement to write SAS code to an associated file. All the three techniques utilize some kind of a driver dataset to drive the program. We are going to demonstrate the code generators using three examples. First, we are going to create variable labels automatically out of a specification file that's in the format of an Excel spreadsheet. Second, we are going to convert variable types and attributes at the same time. The driver dataset in this example is one of the SAS dictionary tables. The last example, we are going to transpose a number of variables. And this time, we're not going to use external data to drive the programming. The driver dataset is from the input dataset itself. Now, without further ado, let's look at our first example. SAS programmers create SAS datasets all the time. We all know that in order for the SAS dataset to be useful, it's important that we add a variable label to the variables that we created. The traditional approach of generating variable labels is to type out a lot of label statements. It's time consuming. It may also introduce human errors that may compromise quality. In our example, we have a specification file that's in the format of an Excel spreadsheet. It contains a lot of variables, including a variable for variable name, a column for variable name, and a column for variable label. It will be really nice if we can use the variable labels that's already in the spreadsheet to create the variable labels of the SAS dataset we generated. To do this, firstly, we need a driver dataset. We use prod import to import the specification file into SAS dataset. In the SAS dataset, we only keep two variables, vname for variable name and vlabel for variable label. Now let's try to do the job using the first technique, the macro variable technique. Here is how it works. After we create a driver dataset, we interact with the driver dataset to create a macro variable to hold the SAS code. And finally, we resolve the macro variable after a label statement in the data step. Here is the code. Firstly, we use prod SQL to read the driver dataset. And we use the select into clause to retrieve the variables out of the driver dataset to build the SAS code. And store the SAS code we built inside a macro variable. And in the next block, we resolve the macro variable after a label statement within a data step. Here is the log after we run the code and also a output from a plot contents procedure. In the log, because we turn on the simple gen option, we will be able to see the SAS code we stored inside the macro variable. And in the plot contents output, we'll be able to see the variable labels we just generated. Now let's try to do the same job using the second technique. It's the call execute routine. Two steps to do the job. After we create the driver dataset, we use call execute routine to build the SAS code and then execute the generated SAS code in only one data step. And here is the code. As you can see, there's only one data step. We use the data step to read the driver dataset, and then we use three call execute routines to build the SAS code. The first and the last call execute routine only contains simple SAS code that will open and then close the data step. And the call execute routine in the middle has the meat of the sandwich. It actually retrieves the variables out of the driver dataset and then builds the SAS code interactively. After we run the data step, here is the log and the plot contents output. In the log, we can see that it will automatically print the SAS code generated by the call execute routines. And in the plot contents output, we will be able to verify that we have successfully generated the labels. Now let's try to do the same job using the third technique, is the put statement. This is the only technique that will actually generate a physical SAS program. It involves four steps. After we create the driver dataset, we associate a name to a SAS program, then we use put statement to build the SAS code. And finally, we include the generated SAS program into our SAS code for execution. Here is the code. Firstly, we use file name statement to associate a name to a SAS program. Then we use a data step to build the SAS code. There are a number of put statements similar to the previous call execute routine. The first and the last put statements only output simple SAS code. And the put statement in the middle will retrieve the information out of the driver dataset and build the SAS code interactively. After we run this code, it will actually generate a physical SAS program. We open up this SAS program, we will be able to see the SAS code generated by the put statements. And lastly, of course, we need to use percent %include to include the SAS program into the code for execution. After execution of the SAS program, if we do a plot contents, we will be able to verify that we have successfully generated the labels. Now, in the first example, we are kind of lucky to have a specification file we can use to drive the programming. In this second example, we are going to show that the SAS dictionary tables are also great resources for driver data set. The programming task in this example is that we have a SAS dataset. It contains a number of date variables. These are the traditional numeric date variables formatted by the date line format. Now, for some reason, we need to convert them to the international standard format. These are character variables. In addition, we also need to update the variable attributes. For both variable name and variable label, we add this capital letter C to indicate that these are character variables. To do this, firstly, we need a driver data set, as we mentioned earlier. It's one of the SAS dictionary tables. It's the dictionary.columns. This data table contains a lot of information about the input data set. For our purpose, we are going to use only two of them, variable name and variable label. All the three techniques we demonstrated previously in the last example will be able to do the job. For our presentation, I'm going to only pick the first technique, the macro variable technique, because in this technique, We can use PROTSQL to directly access the SAS dictionary tables. Here is the code. Firstly, we use PROTSQL to read the driver dataset dictionary.columns. Then we use select into cross to retrieve the information out of the driver dataset and build the SAS code. And then store the SAS code inside a new macro variable. We call it convert code. After that, because we want to look at the SAS code in the log, we turn on the symbol chain option. And finally, we resolve the macro variable after within a data step. After we run the code, here is the log. In the log, we'll be able to see that the macro variable we generated resolved to three attribute statements that will update the attributes and three assignment statements as well that will convert the data type. Now, in the first and the second example, we both use the external data sources to drive the programming. In this last example, we are not going to use any external data sources. Instead, we are going to show you that it's also possible to use the input data set itself to drive the programming. The programming task in this example is that we have an input data set that contains a number of subjects and their clinical adverse effects. The structure of the data set is vertical. It contains one record per subject per event. Now we need to transpose this variable into the horizontal format, which contains only one record per subject. To do this, first we need a driver dataset. As I mentioned earlier, the driver dataset in this example is from the input dataset itself. All we need to do is to add this new counting variable. It counts number of events per subject. After that, we use prot sort no dupe key option to obtain a unique list of those counts. All the three techniques, again, we demonstrated in the first example, will be able to do the job. For our presentation, I'm going to pick the second and the third technique. Now, if we use the second technique, the call execute routine, here is the code. We use a data step to read the driver data set, and then we use a number of call execute routines to build the SAS code. Again, the first and the last call execute. The argument there only contains simple SAS code that will open and then close a data step. And the call execute routine in the middle has the meat of the sandwich. It actually retrieves the counting variable out of the driver data set and build the SAS code interactively. After we run this code, we look at the log and we will be able to see the SAS code generated by the call execute routines. The first and the last lines are generated by the first and the last call execute routines, and those in the middle are generated by the call execute routine in the middle. If we use the third technique, the put statement technique, here is the code. Firstly, we use a file name statement to associate a name, TC, to a SAS program. Second, we use a data step to build the SAS code. We read the driver data set. We prepare the counting variable. We use a file statement to specify the output file location. And then finally, we use put statements to build SAS code. The first and the last put statements, it will only output simple SAS code that will open and then close a data step. And the put statement in the middle has the meat of sandwich. It retrieves the counting variable out of the driver data set and build the SAS code interactively. After that, if we navigate into the folder where that's already specified in the file name statements earlier, we will be able to see that there's a new SAS program that we generated. It's called transpose_code. If we open up this new SAS program we generated, we'll be able to see the code that's written by the put statements. The first and the last line were written by the first and last put statements, and those in the middle were written by the put statements in the middle. And finally, of course, we need to use percent %include to include this new SAS program into the SAS code for execution. This is the end of the examples. Now, if we do a comparison of the three techniques, we will be able to see that the first and the second techniques require less amount of coding compared to the put statement technique. If we use the SAS dictionary table as the driver data set, then the first technique requires the least amount of coding because it can use PROTSQL to directly access the driver data set. In terms of process, the call execute routine is most simple because it has the ability to generate SAS code and then execute the generated SAS code in only one data step. In terms of flexibility, the put statement method is flexible because it's the only technique that will actually generate a physical SAS program which we can open up and modify. The macro variable technique is less flexible because there's restriction on the maximum number of characters a macro variable is able to hold. Now, in terms of system efficiency, if we run the code in a batch mode, the code execute routine is most efficient. If we run the code in the interactive mode, the macro variable technique is most efficient. Here is how we measure system efficiency. For each of the technique, we run them 20 times in interactive mode and then in batch mode. Then we compare their real runtime in seconds. As you can see from this table, if it's interactive mode, the macro variable technique will require the least amount of real runtime. If it's batch mode, the call execute routine requires the least amount of runtime. Today we demonstrate the code generators using three simple examples. For demonstration purpose, we only included a few variables or a few data records. I want to point out that in reality, when we have to deal with a lot of variables, the code generators will save us a lot of time and effort. I also want to point out that in reality, the code generators can be applied to a variety of programming tasks. For example, I have seen people use it to import a variety of raw data files, to perform automatic AE toxicity checks, to perform specification-driven lab grading, to perform metadata-driven mapping for standard SAS datasets, or to assign variable values without writing hundreds of if-then statements. To conclude, today we have demonstrated the SAS code generators are reliable and efficient method that will decrease programming time and improve quality. All accomplish the same results, with each having its own advantages and disadvantages. There are a variety of data sources for driver data set. It can even be the input data set itself. The code generators can be applied to a wide range of programming tasks. This is the end of my presentation. Again, thank you very much for your interest. Here is my contact information, and I welcome any questions or comments. Thank you.